Good afternoon, everyone. This is Tube 87, and to those who keep the Sabbath, I hope you're having a blessed and happy Sabbath today. Now, right off the top, yes, the title says it all. One third will make it to heaven. So that means two thirds won. And to even make it an even bigger picture, we're talking from the beginning of time till the end of time. Now, scripture tells us about certain individuals that we know are going to make it, and it also tells us about individuals that we know aren't going to make it. The devil, or Satan, and his fallen angels are guaranteed a place in damnation. That's scriptural. Adam, Eve, Noah, Moses, and plenty of others are going to make it to heaven. The thief on the cross is going to make it to heaven. We can't walk around being presumptuous and judging who we think are and are not going to make it to heaven, because we don't know. Be concerned about your own salvation, because you don't know if you're going to make it or not. Don't listen to any preacher, pastor, yourself, or anyone else. Understand what you have to do and do it. With that being said, let's get into this quick study about how many are going to make it to heaven. Okay. Originally in heaven, there was a harmony and balance. Now, due to the fall of Satan and all the angels who chose to side with him, there was a void left. So what's going to happen is, which is part of the plan of salvation, that void is going to be filled with individuals who are righteous from this planet. And we're talking from the beginning of time to the end of time. So the time period is dictated by the last soul being reached. So once that last soul is reached to fill that void, because we're talking specific numbers that only the Father knows. We know about the third and the two-thirds, but other than that, we don't know any specific numbers. But once that last soul is reached, Yeshua, who is interceding for us in the sanctuary, is going to stand up and say, "It is done. It is finished." Revelation 16:17, it reads, "And the seventh angel poured out his vial into the air, and there came a great voice out of the temple of heaven from the throne saying, 'It is done.'" This is the time when he stands up and says, "It is done." That means that the last soul is reached and it is time for this mess that we live in to end. So once he stands up, he leaves the sanctuary. There's no intercessor for sin. Understand, people, once there's no intercessor, there's nowhere for the sin to go. It's going to be right on the individual or individuals whom have caused it. You are locked in as to what you are. Now, Revelation 22:11 and 12 reads, at the same time, understand this, Revelation 22:11, it reads, "He that is unjust, let him be unjust still. He that is filthy, let him be filthy still. He that is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still." Verse 12, "And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me to give every man according to his work shall be." So at the time he stands up and says, "It is finished," all those things come into place. Scripture tells us about these things. So if you're righteous, you're going to be righteous. If you're filthy, you're going to be filthy. So whatever you are, that's what you're going to be, because it is done. It's locked in, whatever it is at that time. So then we get ready for his coming. Now, Revelation 21:6 reads, "And he said unto me, 'It is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst of the fountain of the water of life freely. 22, verse 7. He that overcometh shall inherit all things, and I will be his God, and he shall be my son. But the fearful and unbelieving and the abominable and the murderers and whoremongers and sorcerers and idolaters and liars shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. So, listen to what Scripture is telling us. Once he stands up and says it is done, there's no more intercessing for sin. Those who are unrighteous are going to die the second death. Those who are righteous are going to inherit all things. So from creation to the flood, we only know about a few souls that were saved prior to the flood. We know about Adam, we know about Eve, we know about Abel, and that's just to name a couple. Now, once the flood came, we know how many were saved then. Eight souls, and the Noah. Genesis 6:9 tells us because he was perfect and walked with the Lord. Now, 2 Kings 20 verse 3 tells us that him walking with the Lord, or anyone who walks with the Lord, means to be in truth, perfect, and has done good. That's what it's talking about. It didn't mean he was literally walking with him, but he walked with the Lord in doing the things that he was supposed to do. He was a righteous man. Now, eight souls were saved. So how many were destroyed during the flood? Everyone else left on this earth. Now, think about this. Keep this in mind. All those were wicked. They were unrighteous. They were still filthy. They had 120 years of Noah preaching to them to do the right thing. And in the end, they all chose to stay unrighteous, unbelieving. And they suffered because of it. They are going to die the second death. They were all unrighteous. So at the time of the flood, everyone who was killed was unrighteous. There are some that we know are guaranteed damnation. 2 Peter 2:4 tells us that if he spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down to hell. Now, this is talking about the fallen angels that fell with Satan. They are guaranteed the second death. They're being reserved to judgment. So we already know that they're going to take part in the second death. 2 Peter 2:5 and 2:6 reads, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, which I was just telling you about, the eighth person, a preacher and righteous, bringing into the flood upon the world of the ungodly. Verse 6 reads, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them with an overthrow, making them an example unto those that after should live ungodly. So Scripture tells us things for future reference and literally does things and then tells us that it's an example. It should be an example unto us that we should live righteously, or we are going to suffer these same consequences. Okay, go with me to Zechariah 13:8. And it reads, it says, and it shall come to pass that in all the land, saith the Lord, two parts therein shall be cut off and die, but the third part shall be left therein. And verse 9 reads, and I shall bring the third part through the fire, and will refine them as silver is refined, and will try them as gold is tried. They shall call on my name, and I will hear them. I will say, it is my people, and they shall say, the Lord is my God. So we're told that two-thirds in all the land shall be cut off. And this is from the beginning to the end of mankind. Two-thirds will perish into the second death. One third will make it. One third will fill that void left by the fallen angels and Satan himself. Now, it says that this one third will be brought through the fire. Now, this is not a literal fire. Isaiah 48:10 tells us it is the furnace of affliction. They will be refined through going through trials and burdens and all these things. This is what refines an individual. 1 Peter 1:6 says, for a season, if need be, in heaviness through manifold temptations. So that means whatever the case may be, for a season, for a time, it may be your whole life, it may be here and there in your life, but for a season you will go through many temptations. And this is how we are refined. We go through these things, and if we overcome them, it strengthens us because we're going through these things through Him. We aren't just protected and go through it and never suffer anything. That doesn't do any of us any good if we don't go through anything, because it proves nothing. Now, Romans 11:5 says that there is a remnant according to the election of grace. Well, that's talking about that one third, that remnant. Remember, we're told in Revelation 9:27 that a number of the children of Israel be as the sand of the sea, a remnant shall be saved. So remember, from the beginning to the end, and just with the children of Israel, he was told that his number shall multiply, his people shall multiply as the sand of the sea. No man can count that number. So that's why, that's part of the reason why we have no idea about specifics. But we're told that there is a remnant, that one third, that will be saved. Now, Romans 6:13 says, one way to ensure that we're part of that is to yield ourselves unto the Heavenly Father Himself. Romans 12:1 says that we are to present our bodies as living sacrifices. We are to be dead to sin and live to righteousness. We have to let sin die in us. We have to stop doing these things that are sinful. Now, 1 Peter 4:2 reads that he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lust of men, but to the will of God. So we have to stop living to our own flesh, catering to our own desires and the things we want to do. We have to start living according to the will of the Heavenly Father. If we don't do that, we won't make it. So work on ensuring that you're part of the one-third and not the two-thirds that's going to remain here and perish. Live your life according to the word and will of the Heavenly Father, so you can be one of those replacements to fulfill that heavenly home. So remember, each day that you wake up, there is still opportunity. As long as you can study the word, follow the word, and do what is right, you know there's still opportunity, because once the opportunity is up, it is done. So remember, the Heavenly Father does not call on us to be successful. He calls on us to be faithful. This is Tube 87. I'm out.